anybody who lives here, and well, anyone who doesn't really, would know that this seat is the seat of Labor heavyweight and very questionable DJ Anthony Albanese. Now, I'm not messing around here. Albo, very popular guy. Maybe too popular, because we had a really hard time trying to track him down.
4 days out from the federal election and Anthony Albanese's AWOL. We had less than 5 hours to find Albo, and what better place to start than his inner Sydney seat of Grainbluff?
Has anybody seen Albo?
From the markets of Marrickville to the lanes of Leichhardt, Albo was a no-show. But the seat is sweeping, and we needed to sweep the seat.
Why would he be here? He's terrified of anything green. Our local MP is missing. We're really concerned for his safety. Have you seen this man? He's like short.
Give this to your family and friends.
He used to have braces, a bit dorky looking.
Do you know this man?
Yeah, I do. I hope he's gone missing.
He doesn't always look this schmick. He doesn't like to face people and have an honest and open debate. Sometimes he tries to catch it up. He wears a leather jacket, DJ. This fly, I'm just going to keep following you. Do you want to take this flyer? He's very, very elusive. You haven't seen him at all?
Things were starting to strain when a tip came through about where Albo might be.
It's Albo the beer. I guess I'm gonna have to drink 10.
It's really not until you're drinking alone at a bar in the middle of the day that the best ideas come to you. There was one last place we might find him.
Hi, is Albo here?
No, he's in Canberra.
What's he doing tonight, do you know? Is he like watching Game of Thrones? Does he not like us? Like, did we do something wrong?
He's just in Canberra, so I can do it.
Does he not like his electorate, the people of Grainbluff?
I don't really know what you're asking.
Do you watch our show?
No, I don't.
No. No, Albo.
At a time like this, there's only one thing left to do.
Where's our Albo?
Possible. We invited both Anthony Albanese and the Liberal candidate David Van Gough to debate the issues facing Grainbluff. Both of them declined. So we even offered Albo a solo interview, no debate, and he still said no. Nah, boo indeed. And look, thank you so much. To be honest though, for a potential government minister and an incumbent, we didn't think that was good enough. So here he is, the member for Grainbluff, Anthony Albanese, everybody. If anybody here has any questions for Albo, Albo, you're very unpopular. Do you have anything to say to your constituents? Silent on the issue. Do you want to be Prime Minister when Bill Shorten inevitably loses this election? He's got strategy. I'll take that as a no, indeed. All right, well, there's a man that is definitely not silent on the issues, though. It is the Greens candidate for Grainbluff, Mr. Jim Casey. Let's meet him.
Jim Casey, professional firefighter, union firebrand, and now Grainbluff's green man.
Thank you very much. Thanks, man. Good on you. Thank you very much. Good on you. Morning.
Casey came to the nation's attention on the very first day of this election campaign as he and Greens leader Richard Di Natale signalled they were serious about claiming a major Labor scalp.
We're not just there to keep the bastards honest, we're there to get rid of them.
A few days later, the Sydney tabloid, the Daily Telegraph, fired back against a man they called a dangerous lunatic.
That was great. Look, honestly, when the Daily Telegraph tells you that you're doing something wrong, you know you're doing something right.
Casey's used to causing headlines. As the Secretary General of the New South Wales Fire Brigade Union, he led the first major strike in more than 60 years. His early days as a member of the Greens were also controversial.
I would prefer to see Tony Abbott return as Prime Minister with a Labor movement that was growing, with an anti-war movement that was disrupting things in the streets. I'd prefer to see Abbott as Prime Minister in that environment than Bill Shorten as Prime Minister without it.
Casey is now counting down the days to his first tilt at federal politics. And even he admits he couldn't have picked a tougher opponent.
No, but I love a challenge.
Jim Casey, thank you so much for love you, but we're going to launch straight into it. We're going to start by talking about the elephant, or rather the cardboard cutout in the room. Why Albo? Why are the Greens going so hard in Grangelaw?
Oh, it's where I live. I'm a proud inner Westie. It's my home. My children go to school here. I fight fires here. This is where I live. It's where I'd like to represent, and that's why I'm running in Grangelaw.
Fair enough. Now, you say you're running an unashamedly left campaign. Albo says, quote unquote, he's famous for fighting Tories. He's left, you're left. Shouldn't you be fighting Tories too?
Look, Albo's Tory fighting days seem to be taking a bit of a hit at the moment. He seems to be a little bit more interested about what's happening on his left rather than actually on his right. Look, the question's not so much, I think, about Albo and his Tory fighting or me and mine. The question's more about what policies do we stand for and what do the people of Grangelaw want. And I think it's good for our democracy to actually have a choice. And in Grangelaw, people seem very happy that we're offering that choice. And I think it's something to be celebrated, really.
You've been described as an extreme Green, what? As a radical who wants to overthrow capitalism. Do you, Jim Casey, want to overthrow capitalism?
I don't want to overthrow anything. I think overthrowing is one of those words which sort of implies violence, blood in the streets and so forth, and that's not my bag. What I do want to see is us transcend some of the problems the world have got today. And you want to talk about those problems? I mean, look, we produce enough right now on the planet for every human being to actually be looked after with some dignity.
Yep.
We don't do it. That's a problem for mine. I think we should talk about how we might fix it.
We will get to that. You mentioned that you're not about any kind of combat. We did see those comments that you made about Tony Abbott earlier. Does that not suggest that you are more about conflict than compromise?
There's a difference, I think, between non-violent direct action and between violence itself. And look, I defend absolutely the right of every person to take non-violent direct action in the interest of actually changing the world. I mean, that's how we have got so many of the wonderful wins which actually define our society today. I think it's a really important part of political life.
Do you have any concern at all that you're splitting the left vote and essentially making it easier for the coalition to get through?
Look, seriously, no one put a gun to the head of the Labor Party and told them to tack to the right. I didn't force the Labor Party to actually pigeonhole in behind their Liberals on the question of refugees, to keep opening coal mines, to run the kind of agenda that they've run. They've created a vacuum on their left. Someone's going to fill it. And at the moment, it's the Greens.
You said that you don't think the Greens will ever be a party of government because they can't compromise. Let me quote you. This was from June. I think June this year, by the way, you said, I think the idea of a party like the Greens winning 51% of the vote is inconceivable. We cannot dilute our position. If we did so, it would be the end of the party. How can your electorate trust that you'll get anything done with that attitude?
What I said before that was that the idea of the Greens actually forming government without a major shift in Australian society was inconceivable. And I think that's accurate. Like, really, at the moment, the ideas we're putting forward are not majority views. They may be in Grangelaw. We'll find out.
Do you think they'll ever be?
Oh, I think there's every reason to expect they will. Look, Australia, when you think about Australia immediately after World War II and the absolute, conviction that so many people had about the need to start building socialised healthcare, decent schooling and so forth, that was a different world, a different attitude. The Labor Party was a different party in that period. I see no reason to think that we won't see a return to that kind of, sense of collectivity and community at some point.
So can we expect you to negotiate if you end up the second Greens member in the lower house?
Oh, look, if I get returned, if I'm returned, I keep saying that.
Ha-ha! That is a Freudian slip right there. It is indeed.
And his eyes are following me. Yeah. So it's quite uncanny.
Albo, do you have anything to say about this?
Go on, mate. Tell us what you really think. Sorry, the question?
We'll move on. Perfect segue. There is a lot to cover. I want to start with the WestConnex because I know that it is an important issue for a lot of people here in Grangelaw. It is. I know that. For all of our non-Sydney viewers, though, it's pretty much the biggest transport project since the Harbour Bridge. It's basically a major road that will cut through this electorate, including through some houses to essentially help ease the traffic in Sydney. Jim, my question to you is, you're campaigning on a Stop the WestConnex platform. Mm-hmm. WestConnex is happening. What's your platform now?
I dispute that.
The money's committed. There's bipartisan support. My understanding is that work's even started in parts of the M4. I mean, where do you go?
All of those conditions were exactly the same with the East-West Link in Melbourne, and they stopped that. Now, look, really, the tunnels are not dug. It will be a difficult fight to stop WestConnex, but I think it's an absolutely crucial one.
Is it winnable?
Yes, it's got
bipartisan support?
Yeah, I think there's a community to be consulted as well. And certainly, look, Labor's been all over the shop on this. Anthony's saying he's opposed to it. Bill Shorten throws him under a bus and says he backs it in, So,
how do you plan to come through on this? How do you plan to win this? How do you plan to stop the WestConnex?
WestConnex itself?
Yes.
All right, there's a couple of different angles. The first is this. There's $2.26 billion of federal money yet to be shifted over to New South Wales. If I'm elected, I'll be fighting to make sure not one cent of that comes to Macquarie Street. That's one something. That doesn't guarantee the project's over, but it does create a bit of breathing space. The absolutely pivotal question then will be what happens in this community in New South Wales. Look, there's a proud history in the inner west of actually stopping projects like this. Annandale would have been wiped out in the 70s with the freeways they were planning then. Annandale's still there. Okay. I see absolutely no reason, if we get it right, that we can't actually do something around this.
Okay. All right. I think we're gonna have to move on because I do want to get through to asylum seekers. You've got major policy differences between you and Labor. Labor say the Greens can afford to play the moral high ground on this because you'll never have to deal with the realities of a government. Do you accept that?
No, I don't. I mean, look, they would say that. I mean, this is one of the things about Labor's position on refugees. They have not had the moral fortitude to actually stand up to the Liberals on this, and they're ashamed of it. We know that Anthony voted against it in the party room and got rolled. And he's now out there spruiking a position that he doesn't believe in, that he knows that most of Grainler doesn't believe in. But he's doing as he's told, and fair enough, that's what he does.
I mean, these tough policies came into place because we were seeing extraordinarily large numbers of people die at sea. I think it was in 2012. This is from Monash University. It was 400 people in 1 year. That's more than one a day. Do you accept that something needed to happen at that point to stop the deaths at sea? Do you accept that the deaths at sea have stopped?
I accept that... No, I don't, Ashley. Sorry. The deaths at sea are still occurring. Look, people are still fleeing persecution. They're not happening under Australian TV cameras. They're not happening with Australian Navy vessels standing by. But the people are still dying. The UNHCR have estimated that there was 56,000 people at sea somewhere in our general maritime region over the last 12 months. No one knows how many of them died. The crocodile tears...
We can only work with the facts that we've got before us. We don't know how many people died at sea. We know that in 2012, for example, 400 died at sea. Yeah. There are no more dying at sea as we know it. Do you accept that something needed to happen at that point?
I accept that people... Like, we needed to do something around the deaths at sea, absolutely. But the point I'm trying to make here is that I think this policy doesn't actually deliver it. Look, seriously, a death occurring somewhere where we can't see it doesn't mean the death didn't occur.
Yep.
I honestly believe... Thank you.
We're going to have to wrap this one up quickly, unfortunately.
Okay, move on.
Move on. We're going to move on to preferences. We will come back to asylum seekers. We're at the pub. Everybody's going to get drunk afterwards and talk politics,
Absolutely.
Of course. I do want to talk about preferencing, though. The Libs will be preferencing Albo ahead of you.
Yes.
Do you accept you can't win?
No, not at all. No. It makes it harder. I'll grant you that. But, really, I mean, if the Liberals had preferenced the Greens or if they'd run an open ticket, this would be a very different election.
Yep.
It's still winnable, I believe. And certainly, as I said right at the outset, Grainler is going to go Green. I think that's an absolute certainty. The only question mark I've got is whether it's going to be this Saturday or a Saturday at some point in the future.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us, Jim Casey. I had a whole host of questions.